Now, so this is the presentation related to divergent headworks. So first of all, what is headworks? So this is a structure or the works which are constructed across the river. So this is very important. It is across the river and at the head of the off-taking canal. Head of the off-taking canal. So off-taking canal, as I told you while discussing the content or the overview, giving you the overview of the subject, it is the canal which is basically diverted from another canal, or the canal which is taking water from other water channel and it is carrying to the downstream side. So that is called the off-taking canal. So water is being diverted from this structure. So it is the structure which is constructed across the river. So this is important, that it is structure is, this structure is constructed across the river. And thereafter, it is also at the head of the off-taking canal. So this is structure from where the off-taking canal starts. So any canal has got two points, extreme points. One point is where it starts. It is called head of the canal. And the last point where the canal ends, it is called tail of the canal. So head and tail. So head is the point where the canal starts, or the beginning of the canal is called the head of canal. And at the end, where the canal just terminates or ends, that is called tail of the canal. It is of two types. One is storage headworks, another is diversion headworks. As the name suggests, it is used to store water during excess supply and releases the stored water later on when the demand exceeds supply. So during the monsoons, when excessive rains are there, the catchment area collects the water and sends it to the mainstream or the river. So during the monsoon area, a monsoon period, more and more water is coming into the rivers. The total quantity of water available in the rivers is much more than the demand during that season. Okay, that means the demand is lesser and supply into that river is more. So we can say it is excess supply. So during the period of excess supply, this water is stored. And this stored water is released later on, that means after end of the, you can say, the monsoon period, or during the next summers when water is not available in the form of rain. So nothing is being collected by the catchment and sent to the streams. Then this stored water is further sent to the areas where, when the demand is more and the supply is less. So this water is released later on. And this is constructed in such a way that enough storage is made during the monsoon season so that the next complete 1 year can be taken care of with the help of the stored water. Further, next year, in the next monsoon, we will be getting more supply of water and the storage will be filled up again. And then we can use that stored water for the entire year. And generally, if there is a monsoon failure in a particular there was a break in it. I'm sharing my screen again. Yes. So about the storage headworks, so when the excess water is available, we store it and we use that water throughout the year. But in the next year, if the monsoon failure is experienced or the rainwater is not sufficient to fill up the storage again to the full extent, then the storage of the previous year should be little bit more so that we can take care of the next year also. So we need to just optimize the storage for which this structure is provided, so that it can take care of even you can say a monsoon failure also. Okay. Now the next type of headworks is diversion headworks, which is basically the topic of our subject. Diversion headworks, as the name says, it is used to divert the water only, and its function is to raise the water level in the river and divert the required quantity. Okay, so water level is raised into the river and the required quantity is diverted into the canals. It is done, it is provided in the form of temporary spurs. Spur is a it is an obstruction in the form of a wall which is extending from one bank of the river but not reaching up to the other bank. So this is a wall which is starting from one side and it is protruding into the river towards the other bank, but it is not covering the full width of the river. So in the portion where this spur is provided, the water level is basically increased a little, and from the other portion the water is passing unobstructed. So this is spur. So these are temporary structures because with the passage of time they get washed away. Then permanent wear and barrage. This is the complete structure which is designed and constructed, and it is a permanent structure. So the permanent wear and barrage structure is the diversion headworks, which is basically designed and constructed. This is the diagram that I have shown you in the lecture notes also. So components of the diversion headworks. So we have 8 different components. If you just name them, one is marginal bunds, then guide banks or guide bunds, weirs or barrage, then divide wall, fish ladder, silt excluder, scouring sluices or under sluices, and canal head regulator. So these are the 8 components. If I just call them again, marginal bunds, guide banks, weirs or barrage. So weir and barrage, they are coming in single category. So because this barrage section is basically a weir with some special features. So what are those special features? We will be discussing here. Then divide wall, fish ladder, silt excluder, scouring sluices or under sluices, and canal head regulator. Now, marginal bunds and guide banks, I can use a single slide for just explaining these things. In the previous the layout that you have just seen, this, what you see over here is marginal bund is coming in this way, and the guide bank or the guide bund is coming over here. So this is also this is marginal bund, and this one is the guide bank. Okay, so guide bank is basically a pair of these curved and straight structures. These are just the embankments, you can say, or the raised level by earth filling, and these are the raised level in the similar in section by earth filling. Basically, river is confined between these two marginal bunds, and these marginal bunds are generally provided throughout the length of the river. Okay, generally the river, whatever is the normal width of the river, due to meandering, you might be knowing what is meandering. Meandering is when the river changes its course over a period of time, and it gets the sinusoidal structure. So what river does not flow in a straight line or straight path or in a just simply curved fashion. It keeps on changing its path, and that sinusoidal shape of its passage or the path is called the meandering path, and this process is called meandering. And just to control the meandering and just to allow this river to meander in a particular area only, so 3 times the nominal width of the river is basically allotted to the river itself. So if the normal width is say 100 meters, then 100 meters on both sides additionally is given to the river only, so that river can meander in this particular portion. Thereafter, we are providing these marginal bonds. Generally, marginal bonds are in the form of raised ground levels or raised embankments, which are preventing the flood water to go beyond this area into the other areas. Okay, so these marginal bonds are running parallel to the rivers on both the sides. So wherever we need to provide this structure called this diversion headworks or even the bridges or any other hydraulic structure, then there these marginal bonds are curved to such in this way, and they are replaced by the guide banks over there, so that the river is guided, the river water is guided along a straight line. So this double line that you are seeing is basically in the form of this shape, trapezoidal cross section. It is just the earth filling. On this side you are seeing the water channel. There is a water body or water can, means river is there, and on this side what you see is water is there, but it is not in the form of flowing water. Okay, so this is the portion, this portion. So water is coming, it can go here and it can get deposited, it can go in this portion only, but it is not allowed to flow anywhere. Main water is flowing in this direction only. Okay, now this is in the form of a trapezoidal cross section earth filling. Here what you are seeing is the earthen slope only, and this earthen slope is not protected on this side, and on the other side it is protected where the water is flowing. So the other side is protected by this stone pitching. So like this particular slope is unprotected, you can see the earth or the soil directly. The other side is generally protected by the stone pitching. So guide banks are provided on either side of the headworks in alluvial soils for smooth approach to the diversion headworks. As I told you, that guide banks are guiding this river water, and this is provided in the form of a pair, generally mirror image to each other. So guide banks are provided on either side of the headworks. On both the banks you are going to provide one guide bank, and these two guide banks are just like a mirror image of each other, and generally they are provided on alluvial soils where the chances of you can say soil erosions are high. So generally there we need to provide these guide banks. So guide banks prevent the river from outflanking the headworks. Otherwise the river will be meandering and it will be flowing from sides of the you can say the headwork, and ultimately it will be outflanking the headworks. So whatever structure we have made, it is surpassed. So this structure is, it stands useless if it is outflanked. Similarly, the marginal bonds, they protect land and the property. As I told you, these marginal bonds are running parallel to the river on both the sides. So they are generally protecting the land and property of the adjoining area, which is likely to be submerged due to ponding during floods. When the flood comes, the water level in the river rises, and the overall width of the river will also be increased. So these marginal bonds do not allow the river or the flood water to cross certain limits or certain width of the overall area. Like I told you, that the nominal width of the river is, let us say it is 100 meters or say 200 meters, then 3 times the width is provided for the river itself. That is kept, you can say, for the river itself, for the meandering as well as for the flood purpose. So a 100 meter wide river during the floods, it can submerge the adjoining 200 meters, means 100 meter on each side. So 200 meters of the area can be submerged by this flood water, and these marginal bonds protect or prevent this water from coming, going to the further area. So these marginal bonds protect the land and property which is likely to be submerged due to the flood water. So collectively, these marginal bonds and guide banks are in the form of raised embankments. Trapezoidal cross section of that filling is there, like you have seen the photograph. So this is a you can say the Google map view. You can see in your mobile phones also. So this is Harike Barrage. So from amongst you, those who belong to this area, the Punjab, and those who have visited this place Harike in Tarn Taran, so Harike Patan is the area where a barrage is constructed. So this is the Google map view of that particular barrage. So it is called Harike Barrage. So marginal burns and guide banks, where these guide banks and marginal burns are provided. So these are the guide banks. So this yellow. So it is curved from this side, straight, and at the end also it is curved. It is curved here, then straight, and at the end it is curved. And what you see, the structure is provided over here. And these are the marginal bunds. Now I'm removing it. Now you can see this particular shape, and this shape is there. So these are the guide banks, and this portion is being served. You can see some water over here, but water is not going into this area. So this is the marginal bund here, and somewhere here it is not clearly visible. So this green is, that is the marginal bund. That's why I have created it dotted. So these marginal bunds are basically controlling the water, and this guide banks are controlling the water to go into this straight reach, almost straight reach into onto this obstruction. Here what you see is these two guide banks are not exactly similar, they are different. So depending upon the site conditions, we may need to provide different types, or rather different shapes of these guide banks, and different sizes also. And this particular case is when different size as well as the different angle is also there. So they are not exactly parallel. So it depends upon the site condition that what kind of guide banks we need to provide. Next is weir or barrage. So in this photograph, what you are looking at is a structure. And here you can see the obstruction in the form of a wall. On the other side, you can see the water level. It is at this particular level, at this red level only. So water level on this side is higher, and here it is lower. So upstream side water level is more, on the downstream side water level is lower, and the water is overflowing from this wall. So this is a weir wall, which is basically extending up to the full width of the river. And of course we need to carry some bridge, or you can say some connecting road also over it. So sometimes, rather most of the times, we need to provide this weir wall in the form of segments or the panels. So all these panels are further divided by these piers. Okay, so further these piers also provide you the facility to run a bridge over it. So this particular diagram is giving you a clear indication, or you can say the clear difference between a weir and a barrage. You just see it for a minute and just try to understand what is the basic difference. So left one, figure A is called weir, and this B is called barrage. So what is the difference? Base level, if you see, it is same. Top level, which is called the pond level, is also the same. So for this structure, you can assume that on the left hand side we have the upstream portion, on the right hand side it is the downstream portion. Similarly for barrage also, on the left hand side it is upstream, on right hand side it is downstream. Now if you see, this is the cross section of a solid wall, and over it we are providing the shutters. Shutters are generally made of steel. So overall obstruction, the depth of the obstruction is from this bed level to this pond level. And water, if it is not allowed to overflow, it is stored up to this level, which is called the pond level. So this is the depth of water which is retained on the upstream side. If you come to this particular diagram, which is called barrage, here you have a solid wall which is smaller in height as compared to this this rear, and you are providing gates which are made up of steel, and the height of the gate is larger as compared to this diagram A. But the overall pondage, or the, you can say the level, pond level is again the same. So the depth of this storage is from this bed level to this pond level, it is same as that of this weir. It may be same. So the difference is that most of the storage in this particular portion is caused by this solid wall. It is masonry wall, and little bit of storage or some part of the storage is created by putting shutters over it. These shutters are removable. You can add or you can remove these shutters from the top of this crest or crest of this wall. Okay. If you see over here, there is a small height of this wall. The solid wall is smaller in height. So very little storage is caused by this solid wall or masonry wall, and most of the storage is created by adding the gates over it. That means you are putting the barrier in the form of gates, and gate means it can be removed also. If you just raise it above this level, then there will be some opening that will be formed below this gate, and water will be escaping through this opening. That means here you can provide the gates so that you can either raise them or lower them to control the storage. So this is giving you more flexibility. You can remove this water up to this level. So what if you just raise the gates to the maximum extent, all the water will be flowing to the downstream side, and water will be stored up to this level only. Because this is solid wall, water cannot pass through it, so it will not be overflowing unless and until some additional water is coming from the upstream side. Similarly, if you see over here, even if you remove these shutters, this pond level will go down up to this level only. Beyond it, it cannot go. Of course, over a period of time, the water can get evaporated or infiltrated into the ground. So that is another issue. But this structure, the solid wall, is not allowing this water to go below certain level. And this is a solid wall, and it is only a solid platform, you can say. Its height is very small, and most of this storage is created by the obstruction which is caused by gates. Okay, so this is the basic difference. Otherwise, function of these two is exactly the same. Now, this is the comparative table that gives you the differentiation between weir and barrage. It is very important, and many a times it is asked in the final exams or in the MSTs also. So in weir, you can see the storage is mainly due to the solid wall made up of concrete or the masonry. This wall is either made up of concrete, or you can say the stone masonry or brick masonry. So that can be provided. Here, the storage is mainly due to gates. This point we have already discussed. So let's move on to the second one. Shutters are provided on top of this solid wall. These are the shutters. They are provided on the top of the solid wall. And here gates are provided on top of the solid wall. Here we are calling them as shutters, and these are gates. So gates are raised or lowered. This complete obstruction, as a single unit, they can be it can be raised or it can be lowered. But shutters are provided in the form of, say, incremental barriers, say, let us say 1 meter height. If you want to provide 3 meters of additional storage because of it, then you need to provide 3 shutters, one over the other. So these are the heavy, you can say, the barriers of 1 meter height each. And these can be lowered with the help of the cranes. And we can add some more structure, more shutters also over it. So we can have a variable pond level in the form of incremental, say, equal to the shutter height. Let us say this is a particular level of the crest or the weir. Then 1 meter height, you can add one crest, one shutter only. If you just add another shutter, then it can be raised by 2 meters. Add another shutter, it can be raised by 3 meters. So every additional shutter will cause increase in the pond level. And of course, this entire structure is designed for a maximum pond level. Beyond it, you should not provide the shutters, because beyond that, if this water is further raised, then it can be harmful for the structure also. Now, height of the solid wall is more. It is very clear from this diagram. Height of the solid wall is more and height of the solid wall is less in case of barrage. Here, for the weir, cost is less because it is only masonry structure. Little bit of steel is used. Iron made, the shutters made up of iron or steel, they are required over here. But here you are making the provision for gates. So gates are, of course, steel gates. And you have to provide the mechanism of raising and lifting or lowering them with the help of some motorized mechanism. So the overall cost of barrage is higher. The cost of the barrage is more. Last point over here is efflux is high as the obstruction in the form of solid wall is permanent. And here efflux is low, as we can pass the high flood discharge by opening the gates. Now, what is efflux? Can anybody tell me what is efflux? You can answer it in the chat box if you want. The efflux is when the water is flowing in the river and you put an obstruction in the form of a weir wall or any obstruction. The flowing water, which is flowing with a particular velocity, when it is stopped or obstructed by some obstruction, its velocity gets reduced. Obviously, if you are putting some obstruction, its velocity will reduce. But that decrease in the velocity will cause increase in the water level. If you just recall the Bernoulli's theorem or Bernoulli's principle, the overall head remains the same. When the water is flowing with some velocity, depending upon the velocity, v square divided by 2g is the velocity head. And if you stop the water, then velocity becomes zero. That entire velocity head, v square by 2g, becomes the pressure head. So that is basically the depth of the water. So if the velocity is reduced, then depth of water will increase. So whenever some obstruction is encountered onto the flowing water, then on the upstream side of this structure, you will see the water level is raised beyond certain limit. So it is raised. So that additional water level which is raised, that is called the efflux. So in this case, because this water, this solid weir wall is permanent, so this much height of the obstruction is permanently installed in the river. So efflux will be high. When more water is coming in the form of flood water, so this obstruction is going to cause this. I'm sorry, there was a disconnect again. Yes. So in case of barrage, when water is coming, flood water is coming to it. So we were discussing about the velocity head. So when this water is obstructed by this gate, we can just raise this gate and we can cross this water to the downstream side. So if the passage is provided to the downstream side, passage is provided to the water, then there is no need of reducing the velocity, and this obstruction being smaller, it will not reduce the velocity much. And obviously, if the velocity is not reduced much, then the conversion to the pressure head will also be low. So that's why this barrage can cause, can be operated to cause lower efflux. So efflux is low as we can pass the high flood discharge by opening the gates. Now, of course, if you don't open the gate, if you do not open the gate, then in both of these